Hello everyone and welcome to the UMC Utrecht Research Day. So today we'll put research in the spotlight and of course all of our colleagues. We'll have a very interactive program today with video reports, and of course we also hope that the audience will be interactive. And we'll have some more music by the fantastic Bomba Naranja. Great. I think the mood is set, but before I go to my table guests, let me introduce my right hand here, Sander van der Laan. But I think today you'll be Mark-Marie Hubrecht.
Indeed.
And here in the studio also, Rick Verheide, side Rick, right, for today.
Yes.
So Rick, let me start with you. Can you tell us a bit more about how it works with the audience today?
Yes, of course. So if you are at home or elsewhere in the UMC Utrecht, you can go to menti.com and you can log in with the code 877190 24, so 877190 24, log into menti.com so you can be involved here and to start it up a little bit and, well, get you all warmed up. We have a couple of fun fact questions to start with. So the first is, how many PhD students worked at the UMC Utrecht in 2021? And, well, more of a background, we have around 11,000 employees at the UMC Utrecht. So how many do you think will be PhD students here? We'll have to wait a little bit for the results to come in. Some nice music.
Only two voters.
Yeah, only, it's a little bit. But I think we have a lack of time with the, so it might take a bit.
We'll give it some time.
Yeah. Now it's coming. Okay, so it's more or less spread. 1700. It's always when some of the answers gets popular, then the rest also thinks it must be that one. The answer is the second option, so 1600 PhD students here at the UMC Utrecht, so that's more than 10% of our employees. It's good to know for you. So the second question, in 2021, the UMC Utrecht employed 228 professors, full professors. What percentage of those professors do you think are women? And maybe good to know, so the PhD students, we have 60% of them who are women. So maybe it's a little bit different for the professors. The majority votes for 31% being women, and that's correct indeed. So indeed, 31% of our professors is women. And I'm sure that Hester will touch upon that later today. And then the last question for now is, last year we had 3,315 scientific publications published with the UMC Utrecht. And what percentage do you think of those publications were published open access? I think our audience is quite well informed, actually. Maybe they read the jaarverslag from the UMC Utrecht, I don't know, but indeed 97% is the correct answer here. 79, sorry. Yeah,
we wish it was 97.
Yeah. It's always a difficulty with Dutch and English. So please, everyone, stay online on your phone. You will be able to ask questions also to the guests at our table. So please stay online.
Okay, thank you, Rick. You did great. So let's get started with the first table talk. With me at the table, Henk Schipper. You're a pediatrician at WKZ and a fellow in pediatric cardiology. Gimano Ahmad Galim. You're a postdoc at the UMC Utrecht, working with it within the strategic team of regenerative medicine and stem cells. And Bart Steensma, you're a biomedical engineer and a postdoc here at UMC Utrecht. So let's talk about research. Henk, you're a pediatrician, but I hear you are also interested in cardiology. Can you briefly explain to us what type of research you do?
Yes, absolutely. Thanks, Hester. I'm a pediatrician and a pediatric cardiology fellow at the Wilhelmina Children's Hospital, part of the UMC over there. And I see many children with congenital heart disorders every day, also many children with other chronic disorders. And what we've seen over the last few years is basically that their medical outcomes have improved, their survival has improved, but many of them run into late effects of their disease or treatment later in life. And that's something that really worries me on the one hand, but I think it's also a wonderful opportunity to try start preventing these adverse outcomes.
Because they're really young. What is the average age of children that you see?
Yeah, so in the WKZ here at the Uithof, we see kids from 0 to 18 years of age. So children all ages, basically. Disorders can arise at any time. So at the pediatric cardiology department, we see many very young kids, babies, because that's when their congenital heart disorders present themselves.
Yeah.
But obviously, there are also many, many older children.
Yeah, yeah. And can you tell us a bit about the research that you do? Do you do that in a lab environment, or do you do that with cohorts?
Yeah, well, actually, I like to do both, so that makes it also a bit tricky sometimes. But I started off as a fundamental researcher, and I'm still extremely interested in the early etiology of atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, as you know, because Hester is also into that topic herself, so she knows. But secondly, and that's something that arose over the last few years, I really think we can make a difference. We can be impactful if we also focus on prevention of these adverse late effects of chronic disease.
Yeah, so given your broad interest and you're also doing clinical work, what about your research time? Do you have dedicated time for that?
Yeah, so I pay from my veni grant that I acquired a few years ago. I have one day a week. That ends in January, so if there are any sponsors around, I'm very happy to. But no, that is an issue for many clinician scientists.
Yeah.
But luckily, the UMC Utrecht invested a lot to also make that work better in the next few years.
Yeah, with the clinical scientist program. Yeah, that's really great. So next to you is Bart Steensma. Welcome, Bart. You're a biomedical engineer here at UMC Utrecht. Can you give us a bit of an idea of what type of work you do?
Sure. So I'm a researcher in the computational imaging group. What I'm working on is development of a new device based on antenna technology, and we want to make a wearable device that can measure the contractile function of the heart, and we want to use that to prevent progression of heart failure, and we want to use that in the end at home for patients at home.
Yeah, and I maybe you can tell us a bit more about it, because I've been prepared, of course, for this interview, but there was this talk that you have been working in a shed during Corona. So can you tell us a bit more about what that looked like?
Yeah, sure. So during Corona, we actually applied for a very small fund from the circulatory health department, and we got that to develop this device where we had this idea about. And of course, I was working from home, and I really built this first prototype myself. So I was soldering and programming behind my desk, and not really in a shed, but I was doing that at home. Sometimes in the lab here, if they would allow me to. But during those COVID times, I really built the first prototype in a few months. And in a few months from now, we are going to use that further prototype in patients, actually.
Yeah, fascinating. So can you maybe share a bit, because you're developing this device for patients, so can you tell us a bit about your interactions with clinicians or patients? So how do you adapt your technology to them?
Sure, yeah. So very early on in the project, we started talking to Linda van Laken from the Circulatory Health Spearhead also. And she, of course, helped us a lot in developing the clinical application and seeing where there was a need. And the patients we are involving very soon, we're doing a usability study where we're going to test different form factors of the device, and we want to have patients interact with the device to see, okay, what would work best at home or in a hospital environment for different scenarios that we envision.
Okay.
So it's very interesting. So are you going to, is it going to be become come to the market? How is it going to work?
Yeah, we're closely investigating the potential to start a spin-off around this, me and some other colleagues. And I think to make a real impact, to bring this to patients, it will be helpful to follow this route. Because if you want to start larger clinical trials, you will need some form of commercial support as well. Yeah. So we're looking at that very closely.
And so there's not a spin-off yet?
There's not a spin-off yet. We have started those talks with the university.
Very interesting, very interesting. All
right. Great. So next to you is Gimano. Welcome. So we're, of course, also going to ask you, so what are your research interests?
So my research interests are in developing cellular models using patient-derived stem cells, and specifically developing these models, but also using these models to study respiratory diseases. And our main focus now are rare diseases such as cystic fibrosis, but we're all currently also looking how we can use these models for other disease areas as well.
Yeah, so you work in a strategic team, so do you have the idea that you have added value in that? Does that work well for you?
Yes, certainly. So actually I'm in two areas. So first of all, in the child health, but also in the regenerative medicine. Actually, so regenerative medicine can be seen for developing organs based on stem cells, but you can also use these stem cells to make disease models. And in our specific interaction with the children's hospital, so also with the clinicians of the pediatrics pulmonology department, we're trying to use these models to really see if we can test drugs for patients with rare diseases such as cystic fibrosis. And also to understand these diseases better using these models, yes. So it really is an interaction between these different areas.
Yeah, and also within the different disease areas,
if I
hear you well.
Yeah.
So if you can dream big, you know, for the future, what do you dream of?
So actually, also with your spin out, so I think when you're conducting research, you don't want it to be stuck only in an academic setting or having a nice research paper, but really that it's being used in the most broad sensitive way. So also for us, we're now also currently involved in foundation program at Utrecht Inc., which is the incubator for startups. And we're also trying to figure out if we can use the models that we have developed in academia, whether we can use it. We can further explore it for a startup and see if we can develop a startup in which pharmaceutical companies, for instance, can use our models for really screening assays to develop drugs. And I think that if you ask me the question, so what is your dream? I really think my dream is that the models that I've developed are really being used for drug development eventually, and that eventually there is a drug that has been developed in my model. That is actually, the biggest dream.
Yeah, there. So you would really love to have true impact.
Yes, truly,
For the patients. And Bart, besides maybe a bigger, better shed and working environment from home to start these technologies, what do you dream of? If you think big, is it also about impact, or is it about more thinking of, you know, a certain technology that you dream of creating?
Oh, for sure, it's about impact. We're now developing sort of a new modality to measure our cardiopulmonary biomarkers. And what I would like to see in a few years from now is that this is like a mainstay. So next to ECG, you can also use our technology, the RF sensing, to help patients to improve their lives. I think that's my dream for the future.
Yeah. Hank, do you want to share your dreams with us?
Well, a big one would be to launch a pediatric preventive platform in the WKZ Utrecht for kids with chronic disorders.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, fantastic. I don't know what you think, Sander, but...
Very great work. And I would say, especially if you have a spin-off, then try to juggle, you know, the spin-off time with research is very difficult, but also very exciting. Yeah, so
Yeah, you've lived that, right?
I've lived that, yeah.
experienced that, so maybe it's good to get together and share some of those.
Indeed. And I don't know if Rick has any questions from the audience.
Yeah, so one of the questions the audience asks to the table is how important are research grants for your research? So.
Anyone?
Well, I heard Henk say that his support now pays his salary, so how do you see that?
My answer would be critical.
Yeah.
Yeah, without it, you simply can't proceed, right? So, yeah.
Yeah, indeed.
Okay, thank you, Henk, Bart, Gimano, for sharing a bit on your research and also on your dreams. Then we move to the video report, because we know that, here also, we know that research is being done by a team. So we would like to also have other colleagues being put in the spotlight. So take a look at our research heroes.
We gaan Arnold Koekman verrassen. Hij is hoofdanalist bij CDL Research. Ik heb er zin in. We gaan die kant op.
Arnold, hey. Je bent mijn research support hero.
We gaan Annemarie Vastenhout verrassen. Hey. Hallo. Ik zoek jou. Nou, we willen je verrassen met een bloemetje, omdat we zo blij zijn met alle grant support die jij verzorgt voor het UMC. Alsjeblieft.
We gaan nu Petra Berk verrassen, onze kwaliteitscoördinator voor hart en longen. Petra, je bent de onzichtbare kracht voor onze divisie die we bij deze zichtbaar maken.
Dankjewel. Als kwaliteitscoördinator onderzoek hou ik me vooral bezig met het ondersteunen van onderzoekers. De wet en regelgeving rondom klinisch onderzoek wordt steeds ingewikkelder. En daarom is het fijn dat ik daarvan op de hoogte ben en dat onderzoekers bij mij kunnen aankloppen, zodat ik ze daarbij kan helpen.
Je bent de vraagbaak voor iedereen op het lab. Bij jou moet je zijn als je wil weten hoe je een experiment wil doen.
Ik ga Lies Bakker verrassen. En Lies is smartverpleegkundige.
Ik hoor Lies al.
Jij bent mijn research support hero.
Nou ja.
Ja.
Als laatste, en ik denk heel erg belangrijk, laat je de stem van de analisten horen, zowel in de afdeling, in het Circulatory Health Research Center en bij de divisie. En voor dat wil ik je heel graag heel hartelijk bedanken. En daar horen deze bloemen bij.
Nou.
Alsjeblieft.
Verrassing.
Ja.
Smart is bijna nu 15.000 patiënten die eraan meedoen. En zonder jouw hulp was dat ondenkbaar geweest. Dus daar wil ik je ontzettend voor bedanken. Alsjeblieft.
Wat mijn werk bijzonder maakt is denk ik dat wij in een heel klein gepassioneerd team werken waar we in zorg voor patiënten hoog in het vaandel hebben. En waar we dan ook de wetenschap in kaart kunnen brengen voor goede hart- en vaatzorg.
Het bijzondere aan mijn werk is dat ik echt superleuke collega's heb. We zijn echt een team. En daarbij kunnen we onderzoekers en innovatoren helpen met alle randvoorwaarden die er zijn, om hun werk echt goed te kunnen uitvoeren.
Ik vind het heel bijzonder om zo met veel jonge, enthousiaste mensen te werken en te zorgen dat ze hun nieuwsgierigheid kwijt kunnen en mooie nieuwe dingen kunnen ontdekken.
So that was really inspiring. So I hope that you think of your own research heroes. So throughout the UMC Utrecht we have these cards lying around. You can fill it in and tell the people that you work with why you think they are heroes. Maybe to the audience, if you have any examples of times when, as a supervisor or a mentee, maybe you have learned certain things that were important for your career, please share it with us via Rick. And I'm now joined by Dario Kramer. Welcome, you're a researcher at the Utrecht University. We'll talk about your research in a bit, but let me first also introduce Manon Benders, professor of neonatology. It's quite some wording today. Great that you're here. I know you're extremely busy, but fantastic to have you here. So Dario, you did a study on the role of supervisors, and I think you conducted a lot of interviews in the field. So can you share a bit on the insights that you have now after your study?
Yes, I would say it's a
maybe not a study, it's something very informal, qualitative. What we did was look at all the interviews of not the good supervisors, but the very best. So I think I found some common trends, and it's important to note that this is not for good supervision, but really to go the extra mile. I think we have a very good grip on good supervision, on how to do that. But what we notice is that there are some traits, I would say, that really bring it to the next level. And I would say the first observations are that these are usually small to medium-sized groups. There is almost no hierarchy, so everyone is on the same level, PIs, students, master students. And what is also interesting that most of the interviewees, they say that their supervisors and even professors are usually directly involved with the lab research as well. And this is not, I mean, you can ask most PIs, this is not a very common thing. And there's rarely any like micromanagement, so it's a very open environment. But for me, the most interesting finding was that it was never about the research. So anything they talked about was that the priority of these PIs or daily supervisors is that they only care about the student. And they say the student is priority number one, their mental well-being is number two, their career development is number three, et cetera, et cetera. And the research will come. So that's not even in the picture, really. And I found that very interesting.
Yeah, that's fascinating. And I'm just very curious about your own environment. So what are your personal experiences if you are being supervised? What works for you? Do you recognize what came out of this study?
Some of it, yeah. I'm in a fairly large group, so I might not have the same one-on-one interaction that they enjoy, but I get a lot of freedom in my research, and that's also what really made me into the researcher I am today, I would say. So I think that's a good thing. Yeah, and that's really what they all talk about. They have a lot of freedom to develop themselves, to make their own choices, to decide what you want.
So does this? Do these results for your next steps, maybe in science, maybe not, but will you look at team size and how flat the hierarchy is in a group for yourself?
Definitely. Actually, I think that findings like this and also a more focus on the very best of supervision should be an indicator for students on how to look for a research group. Because if you ask students now, they're sort of in the dark. They don't know where to go. They will join based on the research, but usually rarely based on the group. Because if you visit, it's usually not what you see is not what you will get. It's different.
Yeah.
So that would be good to know what you should look for. But I'm not saying that small groups per se are good and that large groups are bad. I'm saying that was just an observation.
That was what you found in your in your qualitative research. Okay, so Manon, I think you've supervised a lot of PhD and master students as well. So what are the most important lessons from your side that you've learned over the years?
Well, I think some things are really sound really familiar to me. I think, first of all, the most important thing is that there's enthusiasm, and we can make them enthusiastic. I think the second one is teamwork, collaboration. That's extremely important. So you have to create a group, because then they feel part of a team, and I think that's extremely important. And the third thing is that they should learn about personal leadership. And that's what they learn along the way, but that's also something which is extremely important for time management, for development, not only into their research, but also on site projects or site things, like organizing a symposium or other things.
And do you recognize what Dario says about group size and flat? What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think the group size doesn't matter. I think it's really the personal attention to each PhD student that should be there, and whether that is from a postdoc or from the professor itself or in a team. I think the well-being should go first, and after that the research will follow. I fully agree.
Yeah, I think over the last years we've seen research groups expanding, which is, I think, a broad phenomenon in science to have large research groups. So do you feel is asked from you as a supervisor, that that has changed over the last years? Do you feel that there's a...
Well, COVID was bad.
Yeah.
That was, I think, something which was very difficult for the PhD students. Either research was stopped or they had to work at home, so there was no group and no team anymore. So if you talk about the last years, that's something, of course, that was very recently. But if you look back, over at least for my, if I look back 15 years, for example, things are, of course, changed. Because I went from a junior researcher to more senior, and then your role will change as well, because you have to put the postdocs forward as well in supervising the PhDs, which is also for them very important. But for what they ask from you, I think the PhD students, I think they're more, they're better in indicating what they need. So I think they speak up more, and I think it's also because, we are trying to create a more a better environment to be able to speak up.
More open.
And just wondering, with the working at home, do you notice any differences there?
Yes, because there was no team. Some PhD students arrived from abroad. They started here, no social network at all. So we also lost PhD students because of that.
Yeah.
And I still see the consequences of that. They are either behind and have a lot of stress because of that. COVID has big consequences. Yes.
And with respect to the, being a PhD is also probably a special phase in your life, right?
Yeah.
Just your personal life. Do you have any take on that?
I think it's an extreme personal development where you're going through. I always warn them, you have your worst times, but you also will have your best times. You have these peaks and also less well moments. And there are also always moments in a PhD which are not nice, and you have to get through it.
Yeah.
At the end, it's nice.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much, Dario, Manon, for this insight into supervision. Rick, maybe the questions for the supervision, we can move that to the next part, because I think in science, that's a very important topic. Thank you both, and let's move to the music.
I'm a shooting star into the sky like a tiger. Defying the laws of gravity, I'm a racing car passing by like Lady Godiva. I'm gonna go, 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 go. There's no stopping me. I'm burning through the sky, 200 degrees. That's why they call me Mr. Fahrenheit. I'm traveling at the speed of light. Gonna make a supersonic man out of you. Stop me now, as I'm having such a good time. I'm having a ball, don't stop me now. If you wanna have a good time, just give me a call and don't stop me now. Don't stop me, 'cause I'm having a good time. Don't wanna stop at all. Okay,
thanks. That was great. Rick, I understand from you that we have some great news.
Yes, indeed we have. So we also had poster presentations today and pitches. We had 66 posters hanging here near to the Heijmans van den Berg building, and also 11 pitchers, and we have a winner here. So that's really cool, I think. At least I think she's here, Grace Keane. She's one of the winners. Yeah, there she comes. Please come stand next to me. Hi, Grace. Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Yeah, come stand up the podium. Yeah. So you did your research together with Rob van Kooi, and you won a prize. So can you tell us really briefly in two sentences what your research was about?
Yeah, thank you. So our research was called the Target Study, and it was a retrospective global study looking at radioembolization, a nuclear medicine treatment for liver cancer. Our research specifically was looking at the variability in the imaging of all the different sites who were included in the study, and how we could try and harmonize to get a better, more consistent approach.
Cool. Sounds really nice. And the nomination, the prize also comes with small grant, €400. Do you already know what you are going to do with it?
Yeah, we have some ideas. So there's a conference coming up next year, which is the European Congress of Interventional Oncology, and it's in Stockholm, which is a notoriously expensive city. So I think that's going to go a long way to helping me enjoy my experience there.
Great. Well, good luck there in Stockholm and enjoy it there. So thank you very much for coming here as well. We also have someone in our hospital ourselves who went there to see it. So Sabine went into the UMC Utrecht and she really took a look at the Beekman's group to see what happens on site. So let's have a look.
Hi, I am Sabine. I'm your reporter today and I'm standing in front of the Wilhelmina Children's Hospital. I'm going to interview Danja Melwey. Let's go.
Hi, Sabine.
You're doing research about cystic fibrosis. What is cystic fibrosis?
Cystic fibrosis is a severe inherited disease that causes thick and sticky mucus to accumulate in several organs, such as the lungs or the guts, and it leads to, well, eventually to severe damage of the organs and could cause death.
So when a patient comes here to the hospital, what happens?
Well, for the organoid test, people with cystic fibrosis come over here to get a rectal biopsy. And in this procedure, we take a few pieces of rectal tissue, which we use to create mini guts to investigate in the lab.
When you require those little tissues, where do you take them?
Well, actually, we take them across the street over there. So why don't I show you?
So that was part one of our video reporter, Sabine. So stay tuned for part two. And then it's time for the next guest at the table. Let's talk about research from three different strategic research programs. Oksana Garatse, you're a PhD candidate at Translational Neuroscience. Stefano Mangia,
right.
welcome. You're an assistant professor at radiotherapy. And Andras Spaan, clinical microbiologist. All the three of you, welcome. So Stefano, I'll start with you.
Yeah.
Can you briefly tell us what type of research you do?
So yeah, in radiotherapy, we look a lot with the MRI imaging modalities at how the tissue of the patients reacts, behaves during therapy. And the main goal for my research topic would be to actually look at these changes from a quantitative point of view. So usually when you look at MRI images, you have these black and white images, so you look how the colors are changing in there. That's not what we should go for, I think, in the long future, because when we want to look at how a tumor reacts, for example, to a therapy, before we see that on these black and white images, it takes a lot of time. If we look at quantitative data, so a sort of virtual biopsy, then you can really look what's happening much earlier in time. So we talk about weeks instead of months, and that I think is a crucial benefit for the patients, because then you can adapt your therapy while doing it. You can look at how the patients react to it, and you can really look into personalization of medicine. And I think that's where we should go into the future, because ultimately we bring to a better patient care.
Yes. So you envision that it will help, you know, having the therapy more sensitive to the patient needs.
Definitely, we can tailor it. So we are looking at precise and personalized medicine.
Yeah, great. Oksana, you're a PhD student. Can you tell us a bit about what you're doing in the UMC Utrecht?
Yes, of course. So I'm now currently in my second year of the PhD, so I have 1 year of research already on there. And I actually investigate how the brain develops. And in that way, we can learn more about the fundamental aspects of brain circuits. So if we really look into how the brain how brain cells from one brain region target the other region, we can learn more about their correct pathfinding and maybe interfere with certain disorders. And I'm doing this by actually taking brains of animal models, label the cells, and clear these brains. So the brain really becomes, you can see through the brain, and then we image them to really investigate where these cells are going. And that's a pretty cool technique, I think.
I think we see it
on the screens,
right?
Yeah, so we can really see individual cells coming from one brain structure, from all the way to from the back to the front. And we can follow them to see how they, at certain time points during the brain development, what they do and how they, what they look like. And if we do then manipulate certain molecules, we can see their effects on one specific cell. Yeah.
Is this a mouse brain?
This is a mouse brain, yes, indeed.
And is it comparable to what we have?
In some way, it's comparable. So we have a lot of silky and gyri, like the those are not present in the mouse brain. So it's really flat outer surface. That's one of the differences. But the dopaminergic cells I'm working on specifically are also present in a human brain. Yeah.
So those are comparable.
Yeah.
It sounds really very complicated research that you cannot do alone. So to what extent? How do you cooperate within
your
brain center, right?
I'm actually in the brain center, yes, and we work closely together with a lot of researchers also in our team, like in the Passerkamp lab. I'm also present in the consortium with different brain centers all over the Netherlands, where we cooperate in certain techniques, yeah. Yeah,
really team science then.
It's a team science, so it's not only UMCU, but it's also from other centers, which is a really nice opportunity to meet other researchers in the same field.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
So Andras, you work in a completely different field, right? Can you tell us a bit what you're researching?
Yeah, sure. So my work as a clinician and as a scientist, that really starts with the observation that for many infectious diseases, actually mild infections are the rule, while severe life-threatening infections in otherwise healthy people, those are the exception. And the question that I try to answer is, how come this huge inter-individual variability in the course of an infection? So what I do is looking if the individual human genetic makeup might explain this variability in between people. So, like a compass, I use human genetics as a tool to really dissect the interaction between the host and the pathogen.
Yeah. So has the whole COVID pandemic, I at a certain point had the idea that the whole world was, working on COVID. Do you have the idea that that still impacts or maybe the opportunities in your field, or is that long gone now?
Well, I think COVID pandemic definitely shows that, infectious diseases have been with us from the early beginning as human beings. And also now it's demonstrating the impact that infectious disease can have on society. So it puts it on the map, and I think that is very important, because also in the future, there will be the problem of infectious diseases, which we are dealing with also in our hospital.
Yeah. And maybe to also go back to Rick about the previous session that we had on supervision. Andras, did you recognize what was said about small teams, flat teams in your field?
Yeah, so what I enjoyed during my whole career is really the interaction with peers. And the interaction with peers is not only formative, but it's also it's a flat form of supervision, in which you can learn from the people that you work with, no matter their rank or their background. So the multidisciplinary nature, but also the interaction, that is really helping a lot.
Yeah. Stefano, do you have the same feeling about that?
Absolutely. And I'm not a doctor, I'm a researcher. And actually being at UMC, it's a great place because you can combine the two fields. Researchers are exposed to what it's really happening in the clinical environment. So we should not only bring novel technologies across, but also look what are the necessities from the clinical side and try to work to ameliorate them. I think that's a key thing. And having both stakeholders and diversity here in terms of researchers and also mindsets, because we're very international as well, I think it's fundamental.
Yeah, that's why we do it in English, right? Because, yeah, great. Rick, are there any questions from the audience?
Yeah, actually, there's a nice question, I think, from a student who wants to become a researcher. And, well, since there are researchers on the table, I think the student wants to know if there is advice how to become a researcher. So.
Okay, yeah.
Anyone?
Yeah, for me personally, yeah? It was you have to be curious and you have to persevere a lot because a lot of experiments don't go well. And you have to, to make sure that you can cope with that in a certain way. And
embrace failure.
Embrace failure and also never lose the curiosity, although your experiments fail.
Yeah.
And creativity comes in. It's curiosity, but creativity as well. And that's really driving science and also like the progress that we make. Yeah. And enjoying it.
Yeah, that's, I think, most
so
important.
Be curious, but also be open-minded and look around, because knowledge is spread around the world. And just don't focus only on your lab and think, I need to work hard to get the results to publish that, but also really be open. That's, I think, a very important thing to do.
And indeed really talk to the supervisor to see how the team functions and works. Okay. Well, I would like to thank all three of you for sharing your research and a bit your ideas on supervision. Then we're going back to our reporter, Sabine, for the second part. Check it out.
Hey, Danja. Hi, Sabine. Welcome
to
Jeff.
The
lab.
Hi, thank you.
So I just explained, Sabine, what we do with the rectal biopsies, but can you show her what you do with it here?
Surely we can. So when the biopsies come at our lab, they are being handed over to technicians, and these people grow organoids from these. And they do this in these specific culture hoods, and these can be shown here.
So you're working on cystic fibrosis, you're working with organoids. What is your main challenge today?
So indeed we work on organoids and on the disease cystic fibrosis. So for cystic fibrosis there are really magnificent new therapies being developed. And these are function and can be used for about 90% of patients. But for the remaining 10%, we really don't know whether these therapies will work, but they can really be life-changing. So we are using these organoids to test whether for these remaining 10%, whether people can benefit from these available therapies. And this is and in this way, we'd like to make sure that they get that people who do not have access at this moment can get access to the best medications as quickly as possible.
Which steps do you need to take in the upcoming 3 years to achieve this goal?
Over the past years, we really looked at how well these organoid systems and how observations in the organoids really correspond to in vivo clinical disease and also therapeutic response. And we're doing this now at a larger scale. So for now, we focus on the newest drugs which are available. So these are available now, I think, for a year or so on the Dutch market. And we're redoing all our tests now with these new drugs to see which of these patients with rare variants of CF can benefit, so we can quickly look at this.
And what personally fascinates you most about this research? What drives you?
Yeah, so I think just the whole concept that you can take an organoid from anybody now in the Netherlands or so, you can just take a little piece of tissue, you add growth components to it, and you can culture these. And the way you can use these tissues for personalized treatment options and really for clinical applications for people, this is really something which is fascinating. So what you try to make in the lab really recapitulates and behaves the same as what's happening also in the patient. And making these links and then also using it actually for personalized medicine, this is something which I think is really fascinating.
Welcome back. We're going to continue our discussion on research with nursing science. And with me here at the table is Sigrid Vervoort. You're an assistant professor of nursing science at the Julius Center, but you're also program coordinator of nursing science. And Elise van Belle, welcome, Elise. You're finishing your PhD, from what I understood, in nursing science. So Sigrid, can you maybe explain more about nursing science and why it's so important?
Yes, of course I can. So nurses play a crucial role in healthcare, and we expect from them to provide safe, quality and personalized care in a multidisciplinary environment. And nursing science generates scientific knowledge for the provision of nursing care, and generates also science what the best patient outcomes are, or for better patient outcomes. For instance, we aim to understand how patients give meaning to their illness, to match care to their specific needs and preferences. We also do studies to develop, implement, or integrate, maybe that's better, a better word, test and evaluate interventions, evidence-based interventions in care as well. And then you can think about interventions that optimize treatment adherence, or interventions in nutritional care to prevent or treat malnutrition in patients that are on a ward. Yeah. And I think it's good to mention that unique also for nursing science is that we seek the perspective of patients. That's an important part of our work.
Yeah, so it's gotten more attention recently. Is it a fairly a new field in science, do you feel, or has it been there for a very long time but no one really noticed?
So it's there for a very long time. We always discuss that Florence Nightingale, the lady with the lamp, was already a scientist.
A scientist,
she did a lot of statistics in her work. So yes, it's quite an old scientific tradition. And in Netherlands, I think, so I'm also in nursing science, the education here at the university. And in the Netherlands, it's now for 30 years that we have this this education. So in the Netherlands, it's since then. And I think the first professor in nursing science was, I think, in 1986, something like
that.
Yeah, and currently it's growing.
Yeah.
But we only in the Netherlands have still, I think, 12, 14 professors in nursing science. So it's still small. Too small.
Yeah, that's clear. Elise, can you tell us a bit about the research that you do within nursing science, so we have a bit of an idea of the type of research you're doing?
Yes, of course. My research area is fundamental nursing care, so that focuses on the essential care activities, which are either physical but also psychosocial or relational care, which can be given to a patient in any setting, but I focus on hospital care. And within this, I primarily look at patient participation in nursing care. So we've set up an intervention to help nurses let their patients participate in care, in which patients are handed a card and they're asked what is important to them during their hospitalization or maybe after discharge. And this was very well received within patients, but it was very difficult for nurses to integrate this into their care. So we did follow-up research to see how we could explain this. And so we did like observational research, and we looked into differences between opinions of person-centered care as experienced by patients and their nurses to see how that differs. So that was very interesting. And we followed up by creating a guideline for academic hospitals on guiding them into best evidence practice, how to improve and enhance their level of patient participation in their hospital.
So I'm just curious, because your research really sounds like a really prime example of the things you do. But how does it fit with the other focuses that you have, maybe Sigrid, the other research that you're doing?
Yeah. So our research group here at the Julius Center, the focus lies on strengthening the quality of care and the effectiveness of nursing care, with the main focus on fundamental care. Elise did name an example of fundamental care and self-management. Mm-hmm. And fundamental care focuses on studies on nursing actions that ensure patients' well-being, physical well-being, and psychosocial well-being. And one of the examples in our team is also a study on the psychosocial needs of patients after having a stroke. It's an example of that. And studies on self-management are more about to understand how patients handle their chronic disease and the impacts that it has on daily life, and how we can support them. So for example, how nurses can support patients with a chronic condition to live as healthy as possible, to monitor the symptoms, to prevent symptom worsening, is another example of this research.
Yeah, sounds really interesting. Really also, again, a focus on prevention or getting worse. So yeah, it's really nice.
Yeah, and really evidence-based.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Medicine. Let me look at Rick. I'm curious about whether there are questions from the audience, Rick.
Yeah, there's one maybe quite provoking question, actually, and that is, are they just women who are doing this research, or are there also men involved?
So do you have men in your team?
We have men on our team.
That's
yes,
great.
We have. Yeah. So it's in nursing science, it's the same as the proportion still in nursing.
What is the proportion?
I think it's 85 female and the rest is male, something around that. So the ratio is the same in nurse science as in nursing practice.
Yeah. And if you want to recruit men who are watching this and thinking, oh, I'd love to do nursing science, how do you become a nursing scientist?
Yeah. Now, it starts, of course, with having the ambition to innovate and improve patient care. There it starts. And then you have to earn your master degree. And of course, we advise to do the Master of Nursing Science here at Clinical Health Sciences at UMC Utrecht. And so for all the men here in the, I'm looking at the camera.
go ahead.
All the male nurses who want to do this study, there's an option within the toekomstbestendige verpleegkunde that you can have finance and the opportunity to start nursing science in Utrecht.
Yeah. Fantastic. Sander, do you have any other ideas about it? You're interested in maybe doing another master?
You have to be a nurse as well, so you have to start to do the bachelor then.
No, I just feel related because my mom is a nurse, actually. And I just wonder, do you also have this button? My mom has this button that I have to give back when she dies.
Okay,
I have to give that back because it's owned by the government or something.
Oh, really?
Yeah, there's really a number on it. It's like an FBI badge, right?
Nurse.
I do have a badge.
Get out of my way.
Nurse, and I do have a badge with nurse specialist as well.
Yeah, okay, yeah.
Yeah, great.
But I don't think I have to give them back. But
okay, thank you very much for this conversation, Elise Sigrid. And let's go to the music.
Gonna be like you. I'm gonna read like you and search like you too. You know it's true. An ape like me can learn to be a researcher too. Yeah, who me do? I'm gonna be like you. I'm gonna read like you and search like you do. You know it's true. An ape like me can learn to be a researcher too.
Okay, and then it's time for the last guest at the table. Arno Hoes, our dean, but also vice chair of the board of directors. Berend Prakke, our vice dean, and you're also the director of the biomedical education. So the first UMC Utrecht research day, what was your impression of the day, Arno?
Well, until now, because we're still in the middle of it, I think it's wonderful. Because obviously we have a dag van de zorg, so about care. We have had, I think, day of education. And I thought it was really time to have a research day. And I'm very glad that it's here in this beautiful surroundings in the morning, starting with, you know, people being welcomed. Also the research support people being really, I guess, you know, really recognized as very, very important here at UMC Utrecht.
Yes.
So I'm really enjoying myself, looking at the posters and the nice music.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
For me, everything's, you know, this is what I hoped for, didn't really expect, but still we're getting it. So
yeah.
I'm very happy about it.
Research party. Berend?
Yes, I will completely agree, of course, with Saul. And one of the interesting things, of course, is that we have also students involved here, and we talked about students. And apart from that, I think Eva Jinek can go home because you can take over. No problem.
Well, that's a fantastic compliment. Yeah. Thank you. I'll keep my shirt closed if you don't.
Please.
You don't remember the joke that she was...
If you look at you from the back on the left, you can't tell the difference.
Well, thanks, guys. Well, at a certain point, you know, you started your PhD as well. You were supervised. So, Arno, what are your most important takes from that period in your life?
You mean just after the Second World War we're talking about?
I didn't want to say that.
All right. Well, it's a couple of decades ago, obviously. But I think it was quite an uncertain period. Right, because it's completely new. You just finished your, in my case, my medical training, and then you're going for a PhD. You don't know anyone. It was a different university. I went to Rotterdam. I studied in Nijmegen, but I did arrive in a very close team with lots of PhDs. But just one of the people said at the table with little hierarchy. You know, on first name. You called the professor by their first name. Well, certainly that took me three months to do it for the first time because
you're
not used to that. But I was happy there, but still was an uncertain period. You know, your first conference, where half of your reference, you know, people, the papers that you're, all the authors of your references is in the room.
You're shaking because you're so
shaking,
nervous.
Not giving a good impression at all. But you learn and you learn and you learn, and you know, as long as you're really your supervisors are nice and help you and understand that it's difficult in the beginning.
Yeah.
So that's why I liked it and I stayed in research essentially.
And did you also during your PhD already started supervising master students? Did that go naturally or?
Well, I don't. Of course, well, naturally is difficult, but anyways, that's what you do, and I like that.
Yeah.
And. I started also supervising some PhD students while my PhD wasn't finished yet. So I really liked that. I liked teaching. But then obviously, you know, you make a lot of mistakes in the beginning, also in supervision. Still make mistakes.
Yeah, we still
personally
do, right?
Every day.
Yeah.
You know, a day without mistakes is a day not lived, in my view. But then, of course, you have small mistakes and larger mistakes.
So now you're making me curious. Yeah. What type of mistakes?
Yeah. Well, my biggest... One of my, well, most prominent mistakes was in my first publication, which was in the European Journal of Epidemiology. I know that's the journal where everybody wants to be in, once in their lifetime at least. Now, it was a new journal then, and because I thought, why are women always zero and men always one in the computer, right? That's how it was done, and I thought, you know, that's nonsense. That was in a period where I was still, you know, very left-wing, long hair. Well, I was a feminist. So I changed that, but I forgot it, you know.
In the paper.
I forgot it in the paper. So it was a terrible mistake. So what I wrote about women was about men and vice versa.
Yeah, so that's how I got my chair, Arno. Thank you.
So eventually you're doing research on men, right?
But I
thought it was women. But anyway, so the nice thing was that I had two publications within a couple of months because I had to publish in Erasmus as well. But that was my first publication ever.
Yeah, Berend, how was your PhD? Yeah. What did you learn from that?
Yeah, I made more mistakes than Arno. That's why I'm vice dean and he's dean. But but what I loved is I did it at the Department of Veterinary Science, and it was always basic scientist. And I loved the questioning and the debates. When you gave a presentation, you wouldn't get beyond the second slide because people were questioning everything. What I hated were the review reports, the anonymous review reports. So I thought of a trick to work with that, so I kept them. I kept them in a drawer, and so I could look at them once in a while. Yeah. So one of the most horrible ones, if I can share that maybe with the younger students, was I still remember it by head. It was a grant I submitted, and the conclusion was after all kinds of, these. So altogether, this is an interesting, yet non-relevant, and thus completely futile experimental exercise. And this was, so this motivates.
Painful.
Yeah, later on we got the work published in a very good journal, but it was really, it helped you. But that's the part that I hated, this anonymous review part, having to submit papers and all of the politics that's around us. And the good thing about Utrecht that we're working on that, to try to change that.
So if I may, because obviously this sounds a bit like open science, so what is your take on this idea of having open peer review?
Yes, absolutely. In everything. Absolutely. Why not? Because I think the fact, I know there are many people say, no, you can't do it, people won't be honest, but they're not honest anyway. And what's the, like I told you, when I worked, we worked in the lab, we had debates all the time on the first and the second slide. Or why can't you do it as a reviewer? And I think it's a mindset that we need to change. The system with closed review is, I think, is wrong. And you know about the bias, which is in also the closed review.
Yeah, and it's the same. Well, it's not only in honors, but it's of course also the same in committees, that you know that there's political decisions that play a role there, which sometimes feel really unfair. Yeah.
It improves your reviewing, right? If you do an open review,
You need to.
It improves because you know you have to think. You know that everybody is seeing what you're doing.
Yeah.
So you know you spend more time. Yeah. You're being. Yeah, you spend just more time, and I think your review improves. Yeah.
Obviously, you can still be honest, but maybe not making these terms like futile or a bit more in the content.
Yeah, and these are the we all know these type of review reports, exactly, which are mostly don't have the content behind because otherwise you don't use these words.
Exactly. Yeah.
And. By the way, interesting is we do a lot about, of course, work also from you on bias training and things like that. I'm just reviewing now a grant for the Canadian government. And before I could start reviewing, I have to do a mandatory bias training online.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So that's interesting.
Leave it to the Canadians.
Yeah. So all these things, I think, are good to make the process more open because they distract from what science is really about setting the right questions and then trying to answer them together.
Sander, any thoughts about open science?
No, I think this is a nice example of discussion, obviously.
Of how we should put that forward.
Yeah, but I do think we need to remain critical on it, but I think having open peer review, like what you say, If you can do it in a discussion among colleagues, then surely you can do it with...
It's science. You should have debates. So make it open. Why not?
I once had a
best friends afterwards. But
I had once had a review that said, you cannot have your cake and eat it. And that was accepted by the editor, which was kind of political
as
well.
Is that the only thing they said?
Yeah.
That was it?
Yeah. Yeah, okay. But I objected and it was accepted, so they're fair
the
editors.
10 words you have to delete without reading,
exactly.
I guess.
Exactly. Rick, are there any questions or suggestions from the audience? I guess people will have questions for Arno and Berend.
Well, there are not any questions, but I looked
suggestions
up...
Suggestions, maybe, then.
I looked up Arno and Berend's open access publication rates, and it's...
Uh-oh.
The worst of the table. Let's put it like that. Let's leave it at that. So maybe you need to explain. Yeah.
keep this close.
Well, obviously there's a bias, right? Because we only just now started with the open access.
Yeah.
But, and I guess when you started, which was pre-World War...
Post-World War.
Oh, okay. Then open access wasn't
was
there.
Pre-World War. Yeah.
that must be a good explanation for that, Rick. Yeah.
No, it's indeed, I think it has to do with the generational issue.
That's it's a generation issue. It's probably the fault of Elsevier anyway.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, many, many, many guidelines, and probably the guidelines are all non-open yet, which is a bad thing to do anyway.
Absolutely.
But we'll have a look at it, Rick. Thanks for reminding
Thank you, Rick.
Me.
Very nice.
Yeah, that's the question we wanted.
Yeah, right? We were looking forward to that question. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you guys for
hosting it.
Yeah, for being at the table and sharing some insights from your own experience. Maybe a last question about flat, non-hierarchical supervision. Is that something that you recognize? I think Arno told a bit about in Erasmus you started with a more hierarchical group. It took you 3 months, right, to say the first name of the professor. But how is that for you, Berend?
I think the basis of a good research group is that everybody is free to ask any questions.
Yes.
And that's so important. So for that, we can help the students to speak up. But more importantly, we have to learn the supervisors to give room for the students to speak.
Yeah.
Because so often they do have the good questions. By the way, what's lacking on the table here are patients. That would be nice to have next year.
Yeah, I agree.
Patient representatives also at the table.
Yeah, that'd be.
Because they also ask, it's about asking the right question. That's the basis of research, of course. And then
I think it should be as non-hierarchical as possible, but obviously there is some hierarchy, right? I mean, you have your supervisor, the word alone, right? Supervisor.
Yeah.
So I think it's and it was pretty non-hierarchical, although obviously there were people who were the boss and you had your supervisors. It's just that I couldn't cope with it, right? Because if someone says, who is 10 years older than your father, says, you know, call me in this case Hans, right? Like, I can't call him daddy, so, you know. So that was easy, if it would have been my father. But that's difficult, you know.
Yeah.
And that's different now, right?
Yeah.
Because now I get, you know, which I had to get used to as well, you know, I get emails from a student saying, hello, Arno.
Yeah. Right?
Never met the student. I had to get used to it, but I think it's much better.
Yeah, yeah. Right?
So I have a name
and
not a function.
Good. Those are great last words. Okay, I'm going to wrap up. That is also, of course, the time to thank everyone who contributed up till now to the research day. Of course, the table guests, but also, you know, the fantastic musicians. We'll hear a bit more about you in a bit. But before we do, we have Rachel Rumai Diaz. She's a spoken word artist. Let me see where she is. Oh, there you are. You have written an ode to research that we will now hear. Take it away, Rachel.
Thank you. The power of science is that it has no power without the people that dedicate their lives to it, that inspire others to search for truths in hidden places, that pass on interests and spark curiosities to new faces. The power of science is that it has no power without people in rooms like these, that seek answers to questions that lead to new discoveries, that have proven time over time that there is power in unity. The power of science is that it has no power without you and me, because truth seekers need to be listened to. They need to be seen. There is no power without the researchers that create new possibilities, that consider sharing knowledge as a great responsibility. This is to all of you who give meaning to the power of science, who have their own unique superpowers. This is to all of you research heroes that inspire, pass on knowledge, seek answers, and work together as a team. This is to all of you that make UMC Utrecht a place that is home to impactful research, game-changing innovations, and pioneering diagnostics and treatments. It is because of researchers like you that UMC Utrecht is known for its great abilities. This is to all of you that have taken big steps in your own journeys of truth-seeking, from building 3D labs that design and print implants that help patients continue their lives, to researching stem cell therapy for newborns with brain damage, from offering remote care for those who need it from the comfort of their own home, to improving diagnosis and treatment in women with possible heart disease. We see you, we hear you, we empower you, because the power of science is that it has no power without the people that dedicate their lives to it, that inspire others to search for truths in hidden places, that pass on interests and spark curiosities to new phases, and especially on days like these, the power of science is that it has no power without people in rooms like these, that seek answers to questions that lead to new discoveries, that have proven time over time that there is power in unity. The power of science is that it has no power without you and me. On this research day, let us dream, because it takes just one wild dream of a researcher to open up ways to new possibilities. This is to all of you who give meaning to the power of science, who have their own unique superpowers. This is to all of you research heroes. Keep dreaming of a new tomorrow. Thank you.
Porta calzone con una stemmaretta, una cupulella cavissiera izzata, passa scampagnando petulete, come un guapo per si fa guardare. Tu fa l'americano, americano, americano, sentami che ti ho fa fa. Tu vuoi vivere alla moda, ma se bevi whisky e soda, poi ti senti disturbato. Tu ballo rock and roll, tu gioca baseball, ma i sordi per camel, chi te li dà la borsetta di mamma? Tu vuoi fare l'americano, americano, 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 ma sei nato in Italia, sentami, non ci sta niente a fa, ok Napolita, tu va l'America, tu va l'America. Come ti può capire chi ti va bene? Se tu le parli mezzo americano, ma quando si fa l'amore sotto la luna, come ti viene in cave di I love you? Tu fa l'americano, americano, americano, sentami che ti ho fa fa. Tu vuoi vivere alla moda, ma se bevi whisky e soda, poi ti senti disturbato. Tu ballo rock and roll, tu gioca baseball, ma i sordi becca me, chi te li dà la borsetta di mamma? Tu fa l'americano, americano, 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 ma sei nato in Italia, sentami, non ci sta niente a fa, ok Napolita, tu fa l'America, tu fa l'America.
Ik heb ook maar gewoon wat gedaan tussen.